many, many times about the number of executions, disproportionately high executions, the brutality, the violence against the Iranian Baloch people that have been under for years, but specifically in the last year, it's been evident to the world. We've been watching it. And we're very privileged and honored to have Professor Payam Akhavan with us, whose expertise is this very question of assessing crimes against humanity. Professor Payam Akhavan is a professor of international law at Massey College, University of Toronto, and he's also a special advisor to the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court at The Hague. So we couldn't have a better placed person who can hear you and then say what we can do. And also, maybe Payam John, you can tell us if what is happening in Balochistan, if what they are, we've heard this morning and we will carry on hearing this afternoon, does constitute something like crimes against humanity. What are the ABCs? And then what can we do? I'm sure that you will have many answers for us. Okay, where are we?
Is this the microphone I should use?
Yes.
Okay. دوستان عزیز صبح همگی به خیر از جناب دکتر لاجوردی و سرکار خانم دکتر کاشفی بسیار سپاسگزارم که به من افتخار شرکت در این پنل با همکاران گرامی رو دادن. I will be speaking today on the 75th anniversary of the adoption on December 9th, 1948 of the Convention on the Prevention and Punishment of the Crime of Genocide. In fact, the first human rights instrument to be adopted by the United Nations, as my distinguished colleague, Professor Rahmani, also referred to. And the following day, on December 10th, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was adopted. And it's important to think 75 years later about why these instruments emerged and what relevance they have for the struggles that we have today, such as the one of the violent persecution against the Baluchi people in Iran. And when we think about crimes against humanity and genocide, we have to begin with the premise that the Holocaust did not begin in the gas chambers. It began with words. It began with the dehumanization and demonization of other human beings because of their identity and nothing more. And that dehumanization and demonization is what is always necessary for mass murder. It is always necessary to deny and disregard the dignity of others in order to justify treating them with such extreme violence. And I say this because some of us may think, what can we do sitting here in London for the people in Zahedan and the others who are suffering these crimes? And it's important for us to know that the beginning of the journey towards justice is the transformation of our culture, is to change the conversation that we have with each other. Turning to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, I also think it's important, following the presentation that we have just heard, to speak about the relationship between territorial integrity and human rights, because whenever we speak about the rights of minorities, immediately there is an accusation that we are somehow promoting secession, we are promoting the disintegration of the territorial integrity of Iran, which is nothing but a cynical pretext to justify the continuation of violent repression. Human rights tell us that human dignity is universal, that every human being deserves to be treated with dignity and with respect. And in that regard, our message is simple: Iran for all Iranians. Iran برای تمام شهروندان ایران بر اساس عدالت بر اساس کرامت انسانی. It is as simple as that. Now, crimes against humanity emerged first in the Charter of the International Military Tribunal at Nuremberg, which was established to prosecute the Nazi leaders upon the conclusion of the Second World War. And there are two important historical lessons here. First of all, crimes against humanity was necessary because many of the crimes of the Nazis were against their own nationals. And in 1945, international law did not yet recognize universal human rights. So it was necessary to create a new category which recognized that some crimes are so shocking to the conscience of humankind that they must be prosecuted irrespective of the nationality of the victims. That is the first point. The second point, which is important, is that at the end of the Second World War, some, including Prime Minister Winston Churchill, Chairman Joseph Stalin, argued that the Nazis should simply be lined up and executed upon the capture of Berlin, whereas it was the Americans who insisted that there must be justice, there must be a process of denazification, the German people must understand the truth and the reality of the crimes that have been committed if there is any chance for a post-war democratic transformation of Germany. Both of those lessons are essential when we look at the question of crimes against humanity, and most important, the question of accountability for those crimes. Crimes against humanity, in simple terms, is defined in Article 7 of the Statute of the International Criminal Court as a widespread or systematic attack against a civilian population through means such as murder, torture, rape and other forms of sexual violence, deportation, but also persecution on religious, ethnic, and other grounds, which includes the discriminatory denial of fundamental human rights. That, in short, is the description of crimes against humanity, and it doesn't take much imagination to understand that what the Islamic Republic has been doing for the past 45 years as a matter of state policy, as a matter of state policy, is to incite hatred and violence against all manner of ethnic, religious, and other minorities. But the real question is not whether these atrocities qualify as crimes against humanity or not. The question is, how are we going to achieve justice, given the fact that the judicial system of Iran, rather than dispensing justice, itself is an instrument of injustice and repression. One can hardly turn to the revolutionary courts, which have been responsible for mass executions from the very early days of the revolution, in order to arrive at justice. Well, we have the International Criminal Court in The Hague. The problem is that Iran, predictably, is not a party to that statute, because why would it recognize the jurisdiction of a court that would turn around and prosecute its entire leadership? The only option is for the United Nations Security Council to refer the situation to the International Criminal Court, acting under Chapter 7 of the United Nations Charter. Once again, we look at the reality of global politics and its cynicism, where human rights and justice are always subordinated to geopolitical calculations, the exercise of the veto power by the Russian Federation, by China, and what have you, which makes that option also difficult to achieve. We do, however, have now, after many years of struggle, the United Nations fact-finding mission for Iran, which is documenting these crimes, including the violent persecution against the people of Balochistan. And at the very least, we must document these crimes. We must establish the historical truth, because as George Santayana famously said, what we forget, we are condemned to repeat again. At the very least, the people of Iran must know what is happening to our brothers and sisters in Balochistan. But beyond that, I think we need to start thinking about what transitional justice will look like in Iran. And my faith is less with the International Criminal Court, where I have the privilege of being a special advisor to the prosecutor, and it is more with the courts of a future democratic Iran. Why can we not start thinking about what a democratic transition would look and how perhaps a special court for Iran, established specifically for the prosecution of the top leadership for their individual criminal responsibility for crimes against humanity, could be an essential ingredient, not simply in a shifting of power from one group of tyrants to another, but a genuine transformation which will finally allow the people of Iran to achieve freedom based on equality. I will stop there and thank you once again for having invited me. And perhaps since in Iran we love poetry, I will share the famous poem of Rumi, who says that there is love in every religion, but love has no religion. And that basic empathy, that basic sense of compassion, feeling the suffering of others, is the beginning and end of our journey out of this catastrophe to a better future. Thank you.
Thank you very much. You've answered some very important questions.